If you need joy,
God's got it.
My God's got it.
God's got it.
If you need joy.
Amen. I didn't look up intentionally because I thought, let the Spirit move when it moves. Amen.
Amen.
Welcome this morning, everyone, to St. Michael's African Methodist Episcopal Church.
Amen.
The Lord is in his holy temple, let all the earth keep silence before him. Let us stand. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below.
Because we thank you for last night sleeping and rising this morning and found ourselves in the land of the living. And Lord God, we thank you for a new day, new grace, and new mercy. And we come here this morning, not for show, but we come here to give you praise. And we just want to say thank you. And Lord, receive this prayer from our heart, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and our soul says, amen.
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 Thank you, Lord.
King Uzziah died,
I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above it stood seraphims. Each had six wings, with two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one cried to one another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the posts of the doors were shaken by the voice of him who cried out, and the house was filled with smoke. So I said, "Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphims flew to me, having in his hand a live coal, which he had taken with the tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth with it and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips. Your iniquity is taken away and your sin purged." Also, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and whom will go for us?" And then I said, "Here I am, send me." This is Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 through 8.
Amen.
Thank you for the last one. This is like a son to me too. He's actually my cousin. I know his name. Because his mama, that's like she my mama too.
Alright, good morning.
Good morning.
We read in John chapter 3, verses 1 through 17. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these things that you do unless God is with him." Jesus answered and said unto them, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus answered and said to him, "How can these things be?" And Jesus answered and said to him, "And you, the teacher of Israel, and do not know these things? Most assuredly I say to you, we speak what we know and testify what we have seen, and you do not receive our witness. If I have told you the earthly things that you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you the heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven but he who came down from heaven, that is, the Son of Man who is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved."
Yes.
This was John chapter 3, verses 1 through 17.
Amen. Let us pray. Most gracious and eternal Father.
Yes.
Thank you once again for this opportunity to come before you. We will ask that you touch and bless each and every person here this day. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, my strength and my redeemer. Let the church say amen. If you would, turn with me to the book of Romans. A letter written by Apostle Paul to the Romans. And we'll go to chapter 8, verses 12 through 17.
Okay, all right.
And as I always say to my St. Michael's family, read the entire chapter, read the entire book of Romans. 8th chapter, verses 12 through 17. And this morning I'll be reading from the Common English Bible.
All right.
And it reads, "So then, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation. But it isn't an obligation to ourselves to live our lives based on selfishness. If you live based on selfishness, you are going to die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the actions of the body, you will live.
Amen.
All who are led by God's Spirit are God's sons and daughters. You didn't receive a spirit of slavery to lead you back again into fear, but you received a spirit that shows you are adopted as his children. With this spirit, we can cry out, Abba, Father. The same spirit agrees with our spirit that we are God's children, but if we are children, we are also heirs. We are God's heirs and fellow heirs with Christ. If we really suffer with him so that we can also be glorified with him." The word of God for the people of God.
Amen.
This letter from Apostle Paul, we remember whom was converted to Christianity, originally hailed from the land in Israel. He was a man of Jewish heritage, and his belief before he swore his allegiance to Jesus Christ, and not surprisingly, it used to be what we might call a terrorist today.
Yeah.
Against the early converts of the Christian faith. Paul's influence, though, on the church and on the Christian thought and practices have been categorized as being profound, as it is persuasive. In other words, Paul brought it direct and straightforward.
Come on.
Some may understand it this way, straight up, no chaser. When he wrote the letter after his conversion from a persecutor, which he had been, from a murderer, a doubter of Christians about the goodness and the mercy of Jesus Christ and what it takes to live a life that is pleasing to God. Paul wrote letters to other churches in the region, to the Corinthians and to the Galatians, to correct their deviant ways and what they thought about God.
Uh-huh. That's good.
Their odd and unusual theological processes that they were dealing with, their ungodly living practices. Uh-huh. But this letter to the Romans wasn't because of a doctrine practice. Matter of fact, the Roman church was doing okay, but this is what happened. They was missing the mark. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. They was missing the mark.
Yeah.
There was some tension between the Jewish Christians,
right,
and the Gentile Christians. Now, we don't have that kind of tension between Christians nowadays, do we?
Yeah.
See, these are Christians. When we look at the entire letter, as I said, we will see the overall message Paul wanted to give to the Romans was salvation is the only way. And with salvation, it could be had by all people. Amen?
Amen.
But this morning, the Lord wants us to concentrate. He wants us to focus in our attention on verses 12 and 13.
Okay. All right.
I'm not going to read it again, but 12 and 13. But before we get there, I have a title, or I would say a question this morning. How much do you owe? Or some folks may say, when we're trying to buy something or applying for credit, what's your ability as a consumer to obtain these goods
That's good.
Before payment?
That's right.
Based on the trust that the payment will be made in the future.
That's it.
How much debt?
How much debt
do you owe? See, this is a conversation we don't want to have, amen? Now, some folks say, this is what some folks say. They say the word debt is a bad word. In discussion of personal finances, even in America, it brings to mind people struggling to keep their head above water. But some type of debt can help build wealth rather than hold people back. The ability to repay both good and bad debt, however, is a key to economic security. Amen? And according to statistics, 8 out of 10 Americans are in debt of some fashion. I'm going somewhere. We work hard. And if we save right, if somebody leave us some money, many people can pay off. You heard me say, leave some money. Many people can pay off this earthly debt. But many people never get a chance to pay off the debt. So what does debt have to do with the scripture this morning, Pastor? I'm glad you asked. Sister Wilson, I'm glad he asked. See, one of our famous poets, songwriters, she penned this following about a little boy that had the in-depth, and in his mind, a serious conversation that he could bring to his mother. And the little boy said, for mowing the yard, $5. For making up my own bed, this week, $1. For going to the store, 50 cents. And for playing with my little brother while you went shopping, 25 cents. For taking the trash out, $1. And getting a good report card, $5. And for raking the yard, $2. Total I owe, mama, is $14.75. Well, she looked down, standing there, and expecting 1,000 memories flash through her mind. So she picked up the pen, and she turned the paper over, and she wrote, for 9 months. Hallelujah. I carried holding you inside of me, no charge. For the nights I set up and doctored you, no charge. For the time and tears, the cost through the years, there's no charge. See, when you add it all up, the full cost of love, there's no charge. See, stay with me, saints. I'm going somewhere. As we take a closer look at this scripture this morning, Apostle Paul, in this version, says we have an obligation to Christ. An obligation, and when you break it down, according to some dictionaries, it means a debt of gratitude for a service or favor. And according to the law, it's an abiding agreement committing a person to a payment or other actions. In other words, a debt that we owe. However, Paul says this debt is not ourselves to live our lives based on selfishness. See, this is where I have to talk about myself for a little while. See, I must make a confession that at some points in my life, I've been selfish, self-centered, self-regarding, self-absorbed, self-obsessed, self-seeking, self-serving, a lack of consideration for other people, concerned with my own profit and my own pleasure. I know I'm the only one still in debt. I know I'm just the only one in here still in debt. Amen? And I know I'm the only one that one is asking the Lord in the morning to forgive me of my debts. Forgive me of my sin. Maybe I'm the only one that see that this is part of this, what we call the Lord's Prayer, amen? The model prayer. Many Christians pray daily or pray when they feel they find themselves in trouble, or when they feel they're down, or when things not going according to plan. Maybe I'm just the only one that said that prayer. Maybe that when you taught me to say that prayer, I remember that. I just, forgive me of my debts. See, Paul reminds us that our real debt is our sins, church. The debts that we have can sometimes causes us to become a little forgetful, but it discourages. We can become disappointed. We become disheartened. We become dispirited, demoralized, deflated, disappointed, let down because we are so far in debt. Hallelujah. We can't see our way out. Amen. And Paul tells the Romans, and maybe speaking to us today that we don't have to stay in the shape that we in. That we don't have to give in, that we don't have to settle, that we don't have to let debt, let our sins consume us. We don't have to die because of our sins. Amen. See, I said I was just gonna talk about verses 12 and 13. But Sister Wilson, I gotta move on. I got two more I'll let it. So I'm gonna take this chance while we have opportunity, church. Paul tells us that we can live by the Spirit. Amen. If you read it, he said the Holy Spirit, and now that is a difference. That is different from our human spirit that allows our bodies to take over, that allows our mind. But the scripture said, allow ourselves to be led by the Spirit. We don't have to die because of our sin. I know the Lord told us to just go here, just stay here, 12, 13, right? Now take the folks here. But I believe the Holy Spirit is truly our God this morning. Yes. Amen. Yes. As I was riding in the church, this morning, my mother was like, I was like, you'll be late. She said, let the Holy Spirit have its way. Amen.
Yes.
Saints, Paul goes on to say that if we are led by the Holy Spirit, we can put to death the actions of our body. And we will live. Amen. Because Paul uses the word body, which we can relate. And we can say that's our human spirit, right? That's how big and bad we are. Amen.
Right.
See, when you go back and read the entire epistle to the Romans, you discover Paul knew when we want to do right, we find ourselves in the midst of evil. Evil is right there with us, amen? See, in our human spirit, we must realize we're just mortals, folks. We're not superheroes. We weak, and the devil knows this, and is constantly present and working and seeking to destroy us. My Bible says the devil is the enemy, the thief that comes to steal, kill, and destroy, amen? But this morning we have hope, church. We have hope, we have a right. We have a chance to pay off this debt, hallelujah. See, saints, as Christians, we must allow ourselves to be led by the Spirit. Paul reminds us that Jesus Christ left us the Holy Spirit. And when we receive, when we accept, when we believe in our hearts, hallelujah, that God is our Father.
Yes, He is.
And Christ is our Redeemer.
Yes.
And the Holy Spirit is real. Amen.
Yes.
The Holy Spirit is real. We don't have to be slaves to sin.
That's right.
We don't have to be weak. When you receive and are led by the Spirit, the scripture says here, we are children, amen? We are heirs.
Stop
being here. I got to come because this heirs thing was working out. I was trying to work it out. Let's see, certain individuals, I'm going to have to read this. In this world, becomes heir or heiress. They usually receive an inheritance, amen? And we may see some of these folks, they get a lot of money, they get some property, they might have some stock options. We may have seen some of these folks, they get fine things that this world can offer, amen? This is the era. They're entitled to something. This is the part of this. They're entitled to something that was left to them. But the truth of the matter, in this world, for them to receive all these earthly belongings, To get all these fine things, somebody has to die. Amen?
That's it.
They didn't do anything to get this. Someone had to. They didn't contribute anything to this. Someone had to. Most of the time, these individuals receive the inheritance. They did nothing. They never worked. But they reap the benefits. Amen. Let me get back. I'm off track. Let me get back on scripture.
Come on, walk with it.
We have a fellow heir. We have an heir. We have a brother. Amen. We got a family member. We have a friend, a loved one, hallelujah, that has paid our debts. Amen. He laid down his life that we may have a right to walk in the spirit. Amen. See, saints, the message this morning is clear. There is debt that we, this world, we cannot pay off. Amen. There is a debt, those debts of hatred and prejudice. There's a debt of backbiting and gospel. Hallelujah. There's a debt of anger and attitudes. Amen. All can be paid and these can be wiped away. If you allow the Holy Spirit to have his way. Finally, Paul reminds us though, he says it won't be easy. That when you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you allow the Holy Spirit to use you, you're going to have some trials and tribulations. You're going to have some sleepless nights, amen? You're going to have to lose some friends. You're going to have to lose some family members. You're going to have some financial challenges. You're going to be mocked and talked about. You have to listen. You don't have to listen to what they say. But then they're going to be naysayers. Amen?
Yes.
And the enemy will always be present.
Always.
But see, we can thank God that the deaths of this world, we can thank God that our sins can be forgiven. Amen?
Yes.
We can thank God because of his love, he sent us a Savior. Amen?
Yes.
A Savior that sent us the Holy Spirit, amen?
Yes.
See, some say it's the spirit of truth, amen? But they call it spirit of grace, the spirit of mercy, spirit of love, an advocate, a comforter, a lily in the valley.
Yes.
See, when we allow the Holy Spirit to use us, we'll get a new walk, amen?
Yes.
We'll get a new talk, amen?
Yes.
You'll start to look different to people,
yes,
amen? When you allow the Holy Spirit, the heavens wave.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Woo!
Yes.
How much do we owe?
Yes.
Every road is open.
When Jesus shed his blood and laid down his life,
yes,
son of us, like you and I, how much do we owe?
Mm-hmm.
When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, how much do we owe? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand. On the back of our bulletins is our Apostle Creed. First, say that together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, in Jesus Christ, the Son of our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary,
suffered under Pontius Pilate,
was crucified, dead, and buried.
Third day he arose from the dead.
He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From the nations that come to judge the living and the dead, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Church universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting.
Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Henceforth and forevermore. Let the church say amen.
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 Amen.